This is again a medical question followed by a sibling question which arises. First, a medical question. What is the level of blood sugar at which the definition of impaired glucose tolerance starts? Impaired glucose tolerance? 140. Impaired glucose, post lunch. 140 to 199, correct? So remember this question, remember the answer, and that is the clue to the non-medical question.
Name an Abhay Deol film. 140, see last local, somebody got it there. Who got it? Please give her a prize. 140 ki last local very quickly answered. Did somebody else also answer together? Okay, give them the prize from Suburban, the box there. Too many? Give two of them at least. Okay. And one more before we go on to the next. Medical question first. What pathology caused by phonotrauma, most commonly in women, is diagnosed by video laryngoscopy? Vocal cord nodules is correct, and your sibling question for the prize. Remember the answer, vocal cord nodules. Right? In India, which company first started selling goods through installment schemes? Somebody said Singer there? Somebody that Singer there. Singer sewing machine is correct. Your prize coming up. Singer's nodules, as you know, are the other name for vocal cord nodules. And Singer sewing machine was the first company to give installments pay goods. Okay. We were going to skip the next lecture, but Dr. Amdekar sir insisted that this lecture must be done today because he's sitting for it. The topic of the next lecture is useless, almost useless, and definitely harmful diagnostic tests. Okay, so we'll come to that, and I'll invite Dr. Tushar Maniar, who will join me for this lecture, because there are several useless things done in pediatrics also. He's trying to find the PPT, and we will quickly have one more sibling question before we do the PPT. Okay, ultrasound makes an appropriate estimate of post-void residue. Approximate estimate, not appropriate, approximate estimate of post-void residue. What makes the most accurate estimate of post-void residue? Uroflowmet is correct, incorrect. Somebody said catheterization. Yeah, simple. Yeah, catheterization after the patient has voided will make the most accurate estimate of your sibling question. Anupam, a single screen theater in Delhi, is better known as what after 1997? Somebody said PVR, Dr. Leena Bhagat, I heard there. Sorry? Now, Uparni. PVR. PVR. This is the first multiplex converted from a single screen. PVR, which was, of course, the post-void residue of the first question. Your last sibling question here, first medical question. In which complication of malaria will you detect hemoglobin in the urine with azotemia in blood? Somebody said? Like what, a fever? Yeah, a complication of malaria which causes renal disease because of hemoglobinuria. What was the punishment? Kalapani is correct. Okay, so that will give me one more question. The hockey stick appearance of anterior mitral leaflet on echocardiogram is a feature of which disease? Somebody said mitral stenosis is correct. Mitral stenosis gives a hockey stick appearance of the anterior mitral leaflet. The second question is, Kabir Khan is seen in which movie? You are too good. Chak De is the correct answer for Kabir Khan. One of only two movies in which Shah Rukh Khan had Khan as his name. Okay. Hmm. sir.
So we'll, for lack of time, we will try and convert this into a
rapid fire.
Yes, rapid fire. That's good.
Yeah.
So we start with the first group that's useless, and Tushar will.
Yeah, we'll have the first
slide. Tushar will start.
Urine sugar. We often see that patients who give blood sugar fasting and post lunch, they are asked to give urine also with the blood sugar fasting and post lunch. And you please tell your patients to refuse to give urine for this because it's a useless test. Yeah. Next. BTCT. Bleeding time, clotting time are now archaic, obsolete, given up. So pre-op evaluation, if you ask for BTCT, don't ask. If you want to do something, ask for CBC for platelet count, PT for prothrombin time, and activated PTT. That's all you ask for. Don't ask because very poor sensitivity, very poor specificity. Next, please. Allergy panels. This is where I'll probably have some disagreement with Suburban. But if you have a patient with eczema, asthma, allergic rhinitis, don't ask for a food allergy panel, eczema allergy panel, 10,000 rupee allergy panel, 8,000 rupee allergy panel. Don't ask unless a patient gives a very specific precipitant. Main nuts khata hoon aur mujhe asthma hota hai. Then you might do for that. But otherwise, allergy panels in general are useless and harmful. But I didn't put this in harmful. Harmful because bichare ko pura zindagi besan nahi khana, pura zindagi imli nahi khana, wo harmful ho jata hai. Next, please. If a patient who's premenopausal female comes with, say, monoarthritis, don't ask for uric acid. Premenopausal females don't get gout unless the patient is on some drugs which include cause hyperuricemia, like hydrochlorothiazide, like chemotherapeutic agents. Don't do uric acid. So there are several such examples where you don't do in certain population some tests. So uric acid is not a useless test, but it's useless in arthralgia with in a premenopausal female. Next, please. If a catheter associated UTI is suspected, meaning the patient has an indwelling catheter, patient has pyuria. If the patient is asymptomatic, not only ignore the pyuria, do not send urine for culture. Urine culture in a catheterized patient without symptoms is useless. Next, please.
So it's my turn to talk now. Yeah. Stool culture, and Amdekar sir is sitting here. He has taught all of us and everyone around him to say that stool culture is a completely useless investigation. You should do culture from a site where you don't expect organisms and they're present. In your gut, the germs are supposed to be present and culturing them is of no benefit at all. In fact, I would even go ahead and say that in most of the time, even a stool routine examination is useless because you can make a decision purely on clinical ground whether you are dealing with a diarrhea or a dysentery. All of you in your general practice and in your clinics come across children with febrile seizures. Please do not ask for EEGs. Febrile seizure EEG ratios are very poor. You will find some technical error or some foci which are not relevant and the child will be unnecessarily put on medication. On the same point, definitely no CT, as sir already said, and no MRI required for any number of simple febrile seizures. And it's not the time to discuss what is simple febrile seizure, but it's fair to say febrile seizures with a normal neurological condition. Continuing further, it should read chronic headache or pediatric chronic headache. The only rider here is, in our previous session on symptomatology, we had done red flags. So whenever there is no red flag in a headache history in a child, please do not do MRI and definitely not do CT scan. It is of no value and does not add to anything else. A good counseling can alleviate anxiety better than a normal MRI. Growth hormone. Growth hormone levels in short stature are again of zero value, and unless stimulation tests are done, growth hormone standalone value is of no use. If at all you are suspecting on clinical grounds and you want to do a screening test, an IGF-1 level is far superior as a screening test. In case they have not noticed.
The symbol?
The symbol, yeah.
Okay.
Why do you think this is almost useless? Can you see this? From far away, if you are not able to see the direction, okay?
Yeah, so some almost useless investigations coming up. The first investigation Dr. Amdekar sir has already touched upon in some ways, but ESR in acute fever. ESR in acute fever is almost useless. Almost useless because of poor sensitivity, poor specificity. The only situation where sometimes an ESR may be useful is when you're suspecting acute or subacute viral thyroiditis, where you can get a high ESR as an indicator of thyroiditis. Again, because there are better tests available, including T3, T4, TSH, you should not rely on the ESR. So almost useless. I have stopped doing completely ESR in almost everything. So I think you can choose your ESR properly. Dengue IgG, everybody knows that in adult medicine, dengue IgG is almost useless. Some people consider it useful in one situation, that if the patient says he had dengue last year with IgM positive dengue last year, and now he has again dengue IgM positive or NS1 positive, and some people want to do IgG, saying that agar last year bhi tha, confirm karte hain last year tha, aur is bar bhi hai, to second dengue may be more dangerous, overlapping the previous dengue, more in chances of dengue shock syndrome, etc. However, in clinical practice, because dengue has become so common, we see second episodes of dengue over years in so many patients, and I have not found in adults, because dengue hemorrhagic fever, dengue shock syndrome is more common below the age of 15, I have not seen adults who suffer because of that second dengue more than from their first dengue. So I'm not going to admit a patient just because IgG and IgM are both positive. How is IgG going to help me? How is it going to guide me? There's no, it will only make the patient panic, maybe make the physician panic, and absolutely no utility. So keep a watch on the patient for edema, capillary leak, etc. But do not worry about IgG. So IgG, I would not do.
So same, on the same note, even in pediatrics, previously we are going to put dengue IgG in adults, and then I said no, even in pediatrics, it's an almost useless or completely useless investigation. Whether the dengue is primary or secondary, your clinical monitoring of the child or the adult is going to remain same. You are going to be vigilant, and how we say calm but alert, that situation should be.
Dr. Amdekar said Bantu in children also now is considered useless. In adults, almost useless, I have written here, because if the patient has a definite tuberculosis, say disseminated tuberculosis, and the Bantu comes negative, then the negative Bantu indicates an inability to mount an immune response. So the patient is somehow immunosuppressed. That might be the only utility, otherwise Bantu in adults, children is useless. CKMB. Now, this is a very commonly done test in ICUs, CPKMB or CKMB, the fraction which is cardiac specific. Gradually, because of the with advent of troponins, this test has lost its value and should become obsolete. It has not become obsolete. SGOT and LDH, which we learnt in our college days as markers of cardiac ischemia, they have become obsolete. SGOT, LDH, nobody does anymore in the ICU. But CPK will gradually lose its prevalence. Another thing that we will discuss in the next lecture with Dr. Dixit is rheumatoid factor. I have stopped doing rheumatoid factor in almost every patient because of a better availability of anti-CCP antibodies, which we'll discuss later.
X-ray chest in asthma. X-ray chest is useless, almost useless in asthma, unless you have red flag signs of decreased air entry on one side, etc. But again, just to differentiate between an acute onset breathlessness of foreign body versus asthma, that would be the only reason or only indication one may do. Just to demonstrate a hyperinflated lung or a small collapse, which is because of a mucus plug in asthma, does not warrant an X-ray. Same applies for bronchiolitis. When you have a clinically diagnosed child, infant with bronchiolitis, X-ray is not going to change your management even in in any ways. I see a lot of reports of vitamin D 25 hydroxy, which of course I'm still struggling to find in pediatrics the use of that, because my alkaline phosphatase gives me enough answers. 125 dihydroxy vitamin D is a completely useless investigation. It does not tell you about the storage of vitamin D. It does not tell you about the condition of the rickets that you are dealing. The only use of 125, I put it as almost useless, because the only reason is when you are looking into a non-nutritional rickets and want to differentiate between type 1 and type 2 of vitamin D dependent rickets, you want to do this particular test.
Just another note on 125. Suppose you have a patient who you have given two injection erythritol shots 1 week apart, and you are giving him calcium and vitamin D, and the patient goes to a lab, says, "Mereko best vitamin D ka blood test karke do." The lab gives him 125 dihydroxy vitamin D, and that comes low. What do you do? So what you have given as erythritol is basically in an inactive form, which will be activated later. So 125 will still be low, or may still be low, and low 125 will make you push more vitamin D, which is harmful. So what I'm trying to say is 125 is not only useless, but occasionally a harmful test, because it misleads you into giving more supplements. Now let's go to positively harmful investigations. Cancer screening is coming under a lot of cloud, and even established cancer screening tests like mammogram, like PSA, are coming under a cloud. And we will have a whole session on cancer screening in our next SOS. So I will not discuss that. The other harmful investigation, Vidal. Vidal is harmful. Why is it harmful? It's useless, we know that. But why is it harmful? Yeah, I have seen Vidal being treated as typhoid in patients with bacterial meningitis, in patients with cavitary Q tuberculosis, in patients with amoebic liver abscess, in patients with pyelonephritis, in patients with pneumonia. Vidal has been taken as the guiding test, and patients, it is a ridiculous test. And I have been requesting pathology.
Maximum number of viral fevers have been treated as typhoid.
As typhoid. Well, right? It is ridiculous. I mean, I make people take an oath in my lectures, students. I will never ever in my whole life, whatever the compulsion may be, will do the Vidal test. Ever.
Yeah.
Yeah. That oath many of you have taken, right? And so yeah, I have, one of our sponsors today is Suburban. And Suburban has circulated a booklet on why not to do Vidal. So I am going to write a booklet for them, that if you are professing that Vidal is not to be done, why are you doing Vidal? So they are forced by their GPs, it seems. But yeah, Vidal is harmful. Vidal is useless. Yeah. Vidal, all that nonsense about rising titer and all is nonsense. So please don't do Vidal. Just don't do Vidal.
We are just waiting for Vidal to go the same way as the IgG, IgM, TB, and soon the typhi dot.
No, but Vidal is resilient.
We want the way to go.
It will not go. Vidal is very resilient. You know, chloromycetin came in 1940s or 50s, and it went. Vidal came in 1896. Vidal was invented in 1896, and it is not dying. So, very resilient test, and it will not go. However, whatever we can do, we should do. Another useless test coming up.
Typhoid IgA.
Coming up. Okay, we have that. Typhoid is that for that?
Yes, that's okay.
Typhoid IgM, typhi dot, or whatever names are given to that. Another useless test. Huge false positive, huge false negative. And all these take away you from doing what matters. When you don't do culture, why don't you do culture? Thoda sa mehenga hai. 3 din ke baad report aayega. So you do typhi dot, 6 ghante mein report aata hai. You do Vidal, 1 din mein report aata hai. Wait, 24 hours mein aajkal on automated cultures, they flash that gram negative bacilli are seen. Another 24 hours they will tell you, this is salmonella, typhi or paratyphi and the sensitivity is this, 48 hours mein aapko result mil jata hai. 200 rupaye 400 rupaye zyada lagta hai magar usse paisa itna sara bachta hai patient ka dusri tarah se.
And no child who is sitting in your clinic or no adult who is able to walk into your clinic is going to be massively affected by even a delay of 1 or 2 days, provided you give him the right diagnosis because of the blood culture.
So any excuse of cost or delay is not valid. It only means that you are not willing to unlearn. Sometimes we have to unlearn. We have to unlearn that we have been doing Vidal for 40 years now. And therefore, we'll keep doing it.
I think I'll go to the next one. Otherwise, Tushar will keep harping on Vidal.
TMT in the young. There are many people who undergo treadmill test, a stress test, because pre-employment checkups warrant the need the test. Large insurance of 1 crore rupees, car life insurance, will need a treadmill test even if the patient is young. Now, this is a problematic test. 15% false positive. We already said that. And TMT do not do in the young. And if you do it, do not disclose the report to the patient if abnormal. H1N1 swab in the OPD. You have seen a lot of influenza in this season. A lot of influenza. Every year we see a lot of influenza in this season. And we know that in this season, in this epidemic, a lot of cases are H1N1, what is called swine flu by the lay press. Now, how do you tackle the patient? When an patient with influenza comes to me and said, tomorrow classic influenza, severe body ache, rhinitis, cough, fever, and he asks me, do I have swine flu? What is your answer? You lie? Do you lie to the patient? I lie to the patient, right? I call it a white lie. I tell them, ye swine flu jaisa wala flu nahi hai. Ye jo newspaper mein aate hai, wo wala flu nahi hai. Ye sada flu hai, jo sabko ho raha hai aajkal. Aur main throat swab karun, bilkul mat karna. Galti se bhi mat jana. Because if they do a throat swab and they get H1N1, oh my God. They panic like nobody's business and they are willing to get hospitalized in an isolation ward in a major hospital and everything is done. So, I first don't get a throat swab or nasopharyngeal swab done, first thing. The only situation where we do a nasopharyngeal swab is in a hospitalized patient because that is mandated by recommendations. Otherwise, we don't do, even if you are going to put a patient on oseltamivir, that is Fluvir or anti-flu drug, you tell them that this drug is used in all flus. It's not because you have swine flu that you are getting the drug. So that's how I do. I don't know how else to tackle such patients or such situations. But I lie. I necessarily lie.
Yeah. So I'll give you my version of this. So what I tell my patients is that your child looks to be having a flu, which could be any other flu, but could be a swine flu also. So far as it is mild, you don't have to worry. And these are the danger signs. If you have any one of them, namely, if your child is drowsy, irritable, not feeding well, not passing urine six times in a day, is breathless, or if you feel that your child is looking much more sick than yesterday, please come back and show us or go to the hospital and show. That's my standard line for swine flu. And as far as doing the test, I am also against doing H1N1 swab in OPD patients or in non-sick patients because your treatment does not change, your duration does not change. The only reason, only place where I do make a change is if there is a pregnant lady in the family or if there is somebody with major illness in the family, in order to give them a prophylactic medicine or not, I sometimes order. But I agree with him that in most situations it's not good. I'll have to pass it on to him. I don't look after people above 18 years of age.
Yeah, so if a pregnant lady comes with flu-like symptoms, and I know it is influenza by clinical diagnosis, what will I achieve by doing a throat swab? By doing a throat swab, I will not achieve anything. Should a pregnant lady with influenza be treated? Yes, most situations you should treat her with antiviral medication. So either way, I will be treating that patient if the safety of the drug is okay. So getting a diagnosis is not going to change. Even in this situation, if there's a family member with H1 with a pregnancy I would give prophylactic if I want to give or isolate the patient, but I would not test, because if it is H5N1, which is bird flu or avian flu, or if it is H1N1, my treatment depends on clinical manifestations. If the patient is very sick, either will respond to oseltamivir, just H1N1 isliye oseltamivir dena, wo nahi. Any flu, any influenza A, I can give oseltamivir. Okay, let's go to the next.
Coming to this, this is very dear to my harmful. Heart again. Yeah, harmful test, CT scan brain in minor head trauma. We have enough reports, enough evidence to suggest that CT is harmful to adults, but even more harmful to children. And we should be judicious in choosing that. That's my case for making a statement that this is a harmful investigation in general. When do we use it? The only place, as sir said, the only place to use it would be a head trauma, or in certain rare situations where in emergency you may have to use a CT brain. What is the definition of minor head trauma? Any child who has no loss of consciousness, and believe me, more than 5 seconds, up to 5 seconds of momentary loss of consciousness is allowed, provided after 5 seconds the child is neurologically completely normal, there is no focal deficit, there is no bleeding, from no evidence of any bleeding. That means no raccoon eyes, no CSF rhinorrhea, no hemotympanum on your examination, and no battle sign or no hematoma post-auricular or over the mastoid region. This will tell me that there is no major fracture. In bigger children, in very small children below 2 years, a non-frontal hematoma would also be considered a red flag. Coming to the two important other areas are vomiting and headache. Any child who has severe headache or worsening headache lasting more than 3 hours should be subjected to a CT scan or a neuroimaging, or at least a close follow-up for next 6 hours. Any child who vomits once also need not have a CT scan done, provided all the other parameters are confirmed. Just from purely from statistics point of view, if there are more than 2 vomiting, even without any of the other, that means 3 or more vomiting episodes after a head trauma, a CT scan may be warranted on case-to-case basis. We put them under intermediate risk, and we generally like to keep them under observation for next 4 to 6 hours. The other problem of doing CT head urgently, the child has had a fall, has been crying, excessively baby's crying and throws up there and is brought to your clinic. You get a CT done, you might miss a developing hematoma which may happen after a lucid interval. CT scan in recurrent abdominal pain. I would even make a statement that without red flags, okay, again we are discussing here our children who don't have any other red flags on recurrent abdominal pain. Even a sonography of the abdomen is an almost useless test. But CT scan abdomen is a positively harmful test. You do not get, there's enough evidence to suggest that there is very poor yield on CT scan in case of recurrent abdominal pain. Also, here one controversial issue between adult and pediatric probably would be a case of acute appendicitis. When you're suspecting acute appendicitis, everyone knows that a CT abdomen is considered a gold standard. But that does not mean that you'd go ahead and do directly a CT abdomen. You do a ultrasound abdomen. If you are able to confirm appendicitis or enough evidence of appendicitis, there is no need to do a CT scan. When you are in doubt, you follow it up with a CT scan. Sure, no problem. And a combined CT, doubtful ultrasound followed by a confirmed CT gives you a 94% specificity in children for diagnosis of acute appendicitis. We come to this last test, which I have written as harmful, which many people will say it is the most important test which is currently available to us. 13 years back, it took $1 billion to do this test. They did a genome sequencing at the cost of $1 billion. Currently, it is available to us at around 30,000-35,000 rupees. Previously, they took few years, I believe, to get the answer. Now we get it in a month or so. So what is harmful about it? You are only getting information. But this information is like, I would say, the Sanjeev in Mahabharata, who can see things which are not to be seen or which are not seen by others. What may happen in future also you will come to know. And so you are not always blessed when you have more information. The problem of genome sequencing is, one, you get to know lots of mutations. All of us have enough mutations in our clinical exome itself, which is only 1% of the genome sequencing. Not all of them, or rather most of them, have no clinical significance. Most physicians who order are not yet trained or equipped to analyze that. That is the first harmful effect. The second harmful effect is what they called as secondary information derived from genome sequencing. So one would come to know of, say, some terminal illness which that person may acquire because of genome sequencing, say a certain cancer or something for which there is no cure available, which that person would have got to know maybe 5 years, 10 years, 25 years later. So that's another major problem with that. And third is an ethical problem, where this information, whether it will be shared with your insurance companies, with your people who employ you, or how you are going to study, and whether it will create a divisive society, we are not sure. So though genome sequencing appears to be promising, as we know, all of us who have learned pediatrics, from when we passed till today, one thing which has surely changed is every disease, almost every disease, has a genetic basis. And when we don't understand what is happening, we tend to say, let's ask for a genome sequencing, maybe we'll get an idea. Like Sir said, ask for one test which answers all. But when you get all the answers, you don't know which to believe and which not to believe. So please be careful about what you choose, when you choose. And unless your test is giving you any specific indication for change in management, only then ask for the test. Thank you.
We'll come to more useless tests, more harmful tests in every session, because this is probably a very important subject. And this was a very, very brief list. So thank you for listening patiently. We are a little short of time, so I'm quickly calling Dr. Anupa Dixit from Suburban Diagnostics to come up on stage for the next talk. This talk is not on your paper. Basically, we are discussing sensitivity and specificity of some investigations. Can I have the